Tuleme kwera bila mangu timukamata tule kulira Njera manyi galina wajeya itanako Tuleme kwera bila mangu tibyetulira biulira Nobulumi bwitamu amala kupimo obusobola Tulwazanga twe mulugunya twefulira ddala bategere mbeera okusinga oyo yagissa mu nkola Tufirwanga twekubagiza twefulira ddala balumiddwa okusinga oyo taata tulaba mu bulumi nga naye tulina kusaba Ntiche tukoze kutukoze na yate kwa sembayo Okusala woku mukama te walio akudamu Tujanjabye tufubye na yate kwa sembayo Obusawo woku mukama te walia buvuganya Tuleme kwera bila mangu
our heart cry that you will not pass us by. Lord, this moment, which is not a surprise, a shock, a disappointment to you, yet it is to us for the passing on of our own Patricia. Lord, we are encouraged and comforted that you knew her even before she was born, and you knew that this time would come to pass. So Lord, even as we go through this moment, we ask you for comfort and strength, especially to the children, to the parents, to the siblings, the relatives and friends. May you be a comfort in this season. Even as we go through this service, we pray for your presence and for encouragement, that at the end of the day, your name will be exalted and glorified. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friends, you are welcome. Thank you for standing with our family at a hard time like this. I want to pray that the Lord will be a comfort in this moment. I hope I'm aware that the children are not yet here, but due to the interest of time, we've got to start so that they'll join us as we move on. On page 3, the order of service. Words of comfort from John chapter 11, verse 25 to 26. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and am the life. He who believes in me, though he dies, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. We brought nothing into the world, and we take nothing out. The Lord gives, and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." God is our refuge and strength, and ever-present help in time of trouble. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies and compassion never come to an end. They are new every morning. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Friends, Paul encourages us as well in the words of his letter to the Romans, that I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor anything to come, nor height, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ our Lord. Even the passing on of Patricia shall not separate us from the love of God. Let's join in that prayer all together. Heavenly Father, in your Son Jesus Christ, you have given us a true faith and a sure hope. Strengthen this faith and hope in us, that we may live as those who believe in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and resurrection to eternal life, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We will go together through that psalm. Psalm 42, it is on page 4. As the deer panteth for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, my God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When can I go and meet with God? My tears have been my food day and night, while people say to me all day long, "Where is your God?" These things I remember as I go around to my soul, how I used to go to the house of God under the protection of the Mighty One, with shouts of joy and praise among the festive throng. Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God. My soul is downcast within me, therefore I will remember you from the land of the Jordan, the heights of Hermon, from Mount Mizar. Deep holes to deep in the roar of waves and breakers have swept over me. By day the Lord my praise is by. At night his song is with me, a prayer to the God of my life. I said to God my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why must I go about mourning, oppressed by your enemy? My bones suffer mortal agony as my foes taunt me, saying to me all day long, where is your God? Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Would you have hope in God? For I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. You may take your seats.
Good morning, brethren. Praise the Lord. I would like to thank each one of you for coming to be with the family in this very trying time. We have received quite a number of friends and we shall try to quickly go through them. I'll ask the team to help us to help us and guide us so that we can quickly get through with this. And the first one is going to be laid by the father, Mr. Dani. Get ready to also after the return to the family. Her very good friend Paolo, after the return of the family, to be Paolo.
Thank you.
Rotary Club of Kampala East. Rotary Club of Kampala East. My grandfather is a member. Rotarians from Kampala East. Thank you so much for supporting your friend and member. Sister Limited.
Number
Hobbies and Lodges of Mengo SS. You can see how she kept friends from as far back as school.
Power. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body.
Second reading, second from Romans chapter 14, verse 8. If we live for the Lord, and if we die for the Lord. So, whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We'll all stand and affirm our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed all together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary.
He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried. He descended to the dead.
On the third day he rose again.
He ascended into heaven
and he seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We will sit. And I invite the Provost, Dr. Rebecca, to share with us the Word of God. Why don't you sing the last stanza as she comes to minister?
You say that you will work. I'm not a thing else to do.
remind us that as saints we do not have anything to fear, especially in the face of death. But Father, it is a reality that fear comes in. It's a reality that pain comes in. It's a reality that we face a moment of grief, and we are challenged, Lord, when it comes to the time of death. But we stand in your presence confident that you are the only comforter that we have in the face of death. And so, Father, we pray that you now hold us. I commit the family once again into your hands, that Lord will uphold the family. Carry each one of us, O God, and minister to us. Father, we pray that you be glorified. We pray that you be upheld by you alone. Thank you, our God and our Father, and even as I share in your word, I trust that, Lord, you speak to all of us. In Jesus Christ we have prayed. Amen. Friends, you are all very welcome at this service as we share together and as we reflect together on the life of Patricia. We bring our condolences as a cathedral to the family, to the father, to the mother, to the children, to the siblings, our sister Justice Olive, and the rest of the family members and friends. It's a tough time, but we want to face this tough time with God. And therefore, we are here to believe God, we are here to trust God, and we are here to entrust our lives in the hands of God, bearing in mind that there is nobody who can carry us in the face of death, but God can. God can because he holds life here on earth and also life eternally. And so this morning we are asking ourselves a question: is it possible to hear God's voice even in hard times like this? And the scripture gives us an answer that yes, it is possible to hear the voice of God even when the times are so difficult. Jesus said these words in John chapter 5, verse 24. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life. He does not come into judgment, but has passed through from death to life. So Jesus speaks these words in a hard time, and he says, whoever hears my word and believes in me has eternal life. Friends, as we live in this world, we live in this world as children of God. We live in this world knowing that we are going. We live in this world in the perspective that the journey comes when you do not expect it. We live in this life when we know that we are going through times that we cannot understand for ourselves. And therefore, there are moments that we cannot hold in our own hands. And that is why it is very difficult for us to think it is just going to be as easy. Life gets so tough at moments. And the moment of death is the toughest moment that each one of us faces. Yes, we know death is going to happen, but it's not easy for us to really be able to know how we will contain when the situation comes. And when it comes, it has come and we cannot reverse it. Right now, we cannot reverse the situation. Death for Patricia has come. But what do we do? What we need to do is to hear God speak, even when the voice does not seem to be clear at such a moment, because it's only his voice that is going to help us go through the pain, the grief, the sorrow, and the challenging moment that we are going through right now. And that is why Jesus says, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life. And that is the confidence, my brothers and sisters. That is the confidence that we have, that we hear his word, and we know that despite the moments that we are going through, we have eternal life. And what a wonderful thing to know, that the person who has gone into glory knew the Lord and has eternal life. My friends, we do not cultivate eternal life when we die. We do not cultivate eternal life when we are somewhere. We cultivate eternal life when we are here on earth. And this is something that we keep talking about every day. It is a reminder that you are going to die, and death is a transition to life. The life where you are not going to share with someone the way you have been sharing with. But for them that have died in Christ, they have transitioned into life eternally. And that is the life that gives us some hope and encouragement to know that yes, we've lost
Patricia in this world. But in the world to come, Patricia is alive because he has transitioned from this life into eternal life. And that is what the Bible tells us, that until the seed dies, the seed has to die, and then after death, it germinates again. And when we die, we germinate to eternal life. And that is why, friends, there is no other life that you can ever think about except life in Christ Jesus. Because it's life, and that is why it says in John chapter 10, verse 10, that as the devil comes to kill, to rob, and to destroy, but I come that I may have life and have it abundantly. What is this abundant life? And what does the devil steal from us? Friends, when we are here, the devil comes to remind you that you're going to live here forever. The devil comes to tell you you can continue to sin. The devil comes to steal your complete life and steal it eternally. And that is why many of us reach a point of death when we do not know Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. The reason is the devil has stolen our lives. The devil steals the essence in us. The devil tells us lies because the Bible says he's a liar and he has been a liar from the beginning. And that is why we live a life like there is no God. We live a life that there is no eternal life. We live a life here of reluctancy, not knowing that one day we are going to die. Friends, after we die, there is no repentance. Repentance must happen here. And we are trusting God that as we go through a series of funerals, this season is tough, and you all believe with me that every day at all saints we are having either one or two funerals every day. And that is sometimes why we limit you on time. We tell you, please work within the time because there is another funeral coming. And that is not easy for us even as ministers. We are heartbroken because we are not here to talk to the dead, we talk to the living. But it is heartbreaking that we go through funeral after funeral. It's not easy. But the best that we can do, friends, is to prepare ourselves for eternal life. To prepare ourselves for the life beyond the life you see here. It is impossible that we attend funerals and after attending funerals, it looks normal. It looks a routine. You come and cry and go and another comes. What about your funeral? Which is yet to come. Yes, you can look at Patricia today, but yours is also coming. And when it comes, what are we going to do? What are we going to talk about you? What are we going to say about you? Have you prepared yourself for life eternal? Or it is about life here? Many of us, the devil has stolen every good about us. And even before you get into the coffin, you are actually dead. Dead in action, dead in thoughts, dead in feelings, dead in whatever we do. We get so scared over everything that is coming around, but we never realize that tomorrow I'm going to die. I need to connect my life with Jesus Christ. Every time there is a dilemma, you know, we are going through Ebola, all of a sudden COVID is rising, all of a sudden, and we are so scared about the dynamics of the viruses. We are not so scared about eternal death. How I pray that we'll be scared that when I die, I'm going to die forever. I just need to connect my life to Jesus Christ. I want to pray that God will connect us to himself. Verse 8, which we read in our second reading, Romans 14, 8 says, if we live for the Lord. If we die for the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. Where is your sense of belonging? It is possible that we don't know. It is possible, friends, that some of us come to church at a funeral because there is a gathering, but no says kahindo. When I ask you, you have no church. But you can gather at a funeral. Friends, this is not just a gathering. It is a warning to all of are living, tomorrow you are not going to be alive the way you are. And you need to be prepared for anything that is going to happen to you tomorrow. If we live, we live for the Lord. And the question is, am I living for the Lord or am I living for myself? Sin continues to accumulate in the world day after day. And we continue to live a life without God. We continue to live a life with no focus. We continue to live a life with no future. We continue to live a life of accumulation of wealth, even the scarcity, the economy that is high. Some of us are focused on what am I getting tomorrow. We are not focused about eternal life. As we gather together to say farewell to Patricia, friends, I want to reconsider. Is God speaking to you eternally? Are you still hearing the voice of God even at such a moment of a crisis? Are you able to realize that there is someone who created you and owns your life? Are you able to realize that the one who created you has the power to terminate your life at any moment when he wishes? Are you sure that when you leave this world, there is someone that is going to find you in heaven? Are you sure that when you go tomorrow, you are going to find another life? My dear brothers and sisters, we are mourning, but let's not mourn like people who do not have hope. We have hope in eternal life. And it is a prayer that the Lord will encourage us and comfort us. But comfort at the time of death does not come when you are not hearing the voice of God. Because then you are hopeless. It's only the voice of God that gives you the reality to know that actually death is only a transition into new life. And that is life eternal. And we pray that as we listen, as we hear the voice of God, we'll not just be encouraged, but we'll just be reminded also to know that we need to go into life eternal. And that is when we know that our labor in this world has not been in vain. In our first scripture, which we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 42 through 44, it says, so will it be with the resurrection of the dead. The body is sown into perishable, it is raised imperishable. So it will be, it will happen. To the resurrection of the dead. The same scripture, chapter 15 of Romans, says that the trumpet shall sound, and when the trumpet sounds, the dead shall rise. And friends, the trumpet sounds, and sometimes it sounds that you have to go, but finally it will sound. And when it sounds, those who died in Christ will rise to eternal life. And that's the eternal life that we speak about. It's not about speaking, but it's about rescuing a soul from hell to eternal life. And I pray that the Lord will speak to each one of us. It does not matter what your religion is. Your religion does not matter in the kingdom of God. What matters is whether you have a relationship with Jesus Christ. You might believe in whoever you believe in, but you might be believing in a dead one. In Christ, you are believing in one who died and rose again. He's not dead, he's alive, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. And that's Jesus. So I want to pray this morning that you begin to have a reflection of life. That life is not here. Life is eternal, and it is lived eternally. In death and in life, we know where we belong. We belong to the Lord. Job said these words. In Job chapter 19, verse 25. For I know that my Redeemer lives, and at last he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been that destroyed, yet in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see for myself, and my eyes shall behold, and not another. My heart faints within me. This was Job at a very difficult time. But even in that difficult time, he heard the voice of God. And he was able to make this confession, that I know that my Redeemer lives. does not matter what the situation is. Friends, it is difficult at Patricia's funeral. But one thing is true, that we who believe in Jesus know that our Redeemer lives. And it's that comfort that I want to leave with you. That you continue to hear the sound of the voice of the Lord in your life. To say that I know that my Redeemer lives. Yes, I'm crying, but I know for sure that my Redeemer lives. I know for sure that my Redeemer lives. And because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, I can be carried another step forward. Because he lives, I'm encouraged and comforted that I will see him face to face. Our God and our Father, we thank you. Because you live, we can live. Because you live, we can face tomorrow. Give us such comfort that comes from your heart. That Lord will be able to hear your voice and hear you for who you are. Lord, it does not matter who we are and what level we are in this world. In heaven, we are children of God. There is no standard that is going to measure eternal life except knowing you as our Lord and personal Savior. Father, do encourage us this morning as we go through this time that Lord will not be frustrated and will not be derailed from you, but will look to you, our Lord and our Savior. For in Jesus Christ we have prayed.
Thank you so much, Dr. Rebecca, for allowing the Lord to use you. You could be there and you are wondering, how do I enter into a relationship with this Jesus Christ? Like she has mentioned, today it is Patricia, tomorrow it's me, tomorrow it's you. Are you sure if your turn comes and you're the one lying here, you know where you go? It's very important for you to make a choice right now. Truly, we are not praying for Patricia, we are praying for us the living. And so I want to give someone an opportunity. You are there and you sincerely want to rescue your eternal life, your life to eternity. We are all going to close our eyes. Just quietly, deep inside you, answer yourself. Answer yourself a question. If Jesus came for me today, will I be able to see him? Do I hear his voice? If I get into the place where Patricia is, what's my destiny? Please answer yourself if you're asking those questions to yourself. Are you sure you'll go to heaven? Because you are either in heaven or you go to hell. The choice is made right now. If you want to make that choice right now, and you're saying, surely I want to have eternal life, repeat this prayer after me. Lord Jesus, I thank you for your death on the cross, because you rose again and went to prepare a place for me. Where you are, I want to see you when my turn comes. So Lord, I have heard your voice knocking at the door of my heart. I open my heart, I invite you in my heart. I receive you as Lord and Savior. Forgive all my sins. Remove my name from the book of the dead and write my name in the book of life. Today, I am saved. I am born again, for I have become your child. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you have said that word, I mean that prayer, and you sincerely mean it, please, we are available. We'd like to help you walk with the Lord Jesus Christ for your remaining days here on earth. And if you are, or you already said it, but you just committed, please be encouraged to go where you pray and share with your leaders in your church, in your churches, so that they can help you walk the walk of salvation. We are going to sing Amazing Grace as we offer. We are going to have baskets spread around us. And as you give, please be mindful of your property, of belongings. Be aware that even as we are mourning, there are some people who are on duty. So if you're on duty, may the Holy Spirit arrest you so that you will not end in hell. Amen. Please quiet.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch. but also with respect. And the ministers and MPs present have recognized their capacity and we are also honored. Let me first try to when I do this, yes, and there are many in the congregation who are. So really, we should be making them feel a little less pain than we feel. But then, the one who is supposed to do that is himself in need of counseling. So bear with me if occasionally I might fall on this responsibility. We have roses. Member of our small family. Depending on where you look from, what is a relatively small family if you look at me, the mother of the children, we are just six of us. But out of six, going for about 40 something years, has grown a family which is no longer small. So I address myself to the smaller family, but that smaller family is supported by my larger family. I'm not from a small family. My father, 12 children. My father died in 1973 and he was 84, 85. On the 30th November, I became 84. I'm the only male in our family who has reached my father's age. Brothers, you are five, or died before this age. My sisters are the ones who have tried. They were seven. He's 92. I'm their baby. I'm from the 12th. I am their baby. I'm from the 12th. I was the 12th. So, out of this 12, obviously, some of the issues, the results of the 12, some are here. In fact, my immediate big brother, has a presentation, but those almost literally became my younger brothers, because he was the first born, I was the last born. So he became literally real, like my father. So we are from a large family. Actually, he had a bigger brother. Me and his father was older than my sister. Patricia, I think this place we call it a love child. Yes, you cannot hesitate to disclose that both Patricia and Sheila were love children. But Sheila, I was given immediately. And when I got married officially, Sheila was at my house. But Patricia, I was not given immediately. And she joined our family a little later. Patricia's mother, Patricia's brothers and sisters are with us. And they have really done a great job in this bereavement because they agreed. We asked them and they agreed to move Patricia's home and keep it when she was no longer there. Because without the children, without Patricia, that house would have been empty. Christine, therefore, Christine, whoever's on you.
She went to Kitante rather than
Otherwise, everybody was a government school, but it was a good government school. And then went to Mengo SS, and went to Makerere College School, and went to Makerere. No hassle. The school fees somehow were there. And finished school, and I think through Christine's effort, there was a course in London which she took and it lasted a year. And then she came and started working. I think that hitch in London accounted for the fashion sense. Yes, there was a fashion sense in this town, which you saw, because for me, at least at my house, there was very little that lipstick. But when she came, we had great use to lipstick now. So, the professional knowledge should move very quickly. She worked. She dressed her horses. She did some very, very great things. But especially, she made friends. She was good at keeping friends. You make many. But the old song tells you, make them. Make new friends for God's sake. But keep the old. I think she was good at this. She eventually, among the friends, she later attracted a man who's with us and got married early. Yeah. That is why you are looking at a 21-year-old, third-year university in Manchester. That is the first born. Then her sibling sister has just started first year. Also a good thing. So really, and then as a family, he was a star in the family. Once she entered the room, you would have to laugh. She would do all sorts of things which wasn't a conduit. But you end up really easy girl, whatever might have been the issue. So we have lost the star. But it is nothing permanent in this world, that's what I'm told. When I celebrated in the fourth, she was at her house. She didn't join us, but everybody else was at the house with a cake. There are no guarantees. You can do it. What have I done to make it? Nothing. Except you didn't catch it, that's all. And I mean, all my friends would have me later for them. But, yes, there is something when the Lord gives you that love, then He also gives you a chance to look at it. And probably either be or do something that will be for aid or help someone else. My family has lost one of us. We mourn. But our attention surely should be on them, not on us. With us, then you should know, I've talked to my niece, Alan, who is in London, who has been in London for 32 years. And her husband, Dani, to take on the responsibility of those who are poor, if you don't mind. Our responsibility should be that. Our responsibility should be to remember her and make her live. Make her live through us. She thought she was young, she never young. And when I talk of 47 or 48, remember, the Honorable Justice, Margaret Jerry, whom we accompanied like this, when the Zambia and the world, was also 49 years old. So, did I hear? I think someone will say, because they are also needed in heaven. But who am I to argue? Let's do our best in this world. Maybe it will help us, maybe it will help somebody else. Let me thank first the church. Church, which is a beauty we know. But thank you for helping us to deal with this step of Patricia's journey. I also thank my Rotary Club. The Rotary Club of Kampala East is represented here. Indeed, there is a team. But this is not a trouble for me. We contributed 2 points of
and continue to pray that God strengthens you
in the days after this. The interest of time, let us invite Auntie Christie, who is Patricia's mother, to come and give us a message.
Kama mluji, sera chona. Nyamuri parifrant, ababulisi, wakwaya, buna wabira mtifokyo, kabawiriza. Abakungu vazimona, mubitivi ya mwe, mbebaza. Okujja okunsibulira omwana wange Patricia Kente. Mwebale nnyo, mwebalire ddala. Patricia ono atuuse. Bano be baana be yakula nabo obulungi ennyo. Patricia nabeera mwana mulungi. Natusanyusa mu famire yaffe. Ne tukola kyonna ekisoboka. Ne tunaffe tumusanyusa kubanga yali atusanyusa. Pananga bakungubazi munyambe kubanga ze Patricia sagala kumwe kwasa muntu mulala yenna kumanga mmanyi yagenze omukulu era njagala Patricia abeere ngali mumaaso ga Katonda amuweereza amusinza amutendereza naffe tumusange pananga nasanyuka nnyo lwe nagenda wa Patricia Kente kusande eri netubeera naye netulya naye awaka netufukamira netusaba Patricia nabeera very very humble nafukamira nga tusaba nemutunuulira bwenti nemanya nti nendowooza mulyene nga mumwana nkali very humble before God ngamusizaamu nnyo ekitiibwa nekitwala bwentyo mpolampola naye netukontinue ng'okusaba era nebaza Katonda emyaka gino gyamutuwadde kibadde mirungi tusobola kugamba nti tegibadde mirungi tubadde mirungi nnyo twebaza Katonda naye Katonda kimusa kyemwegayirira the Holy Spirit omwana wange amuyambe abeere ng'aweereza Katonda mu ggulu kyokka kye njala okusobola Patricia Katonda kyaba nnyambamu naffe abasigaddewo bannange twekaze Mukama nze nabadde simanyi nti Patricia agenda kufa nabadde simanyi naye kaakati ntegedde ddala kigambo kye bayita kufa twekwase Katonda bannange twekwase Katonda tubeere nga tumusinza nga tumugulumiza nga tumanyi nti Katonda waffe yatutonda ali waggulu ne wansi Katonda ono anyambe omwana wange abeere nga buli kaseera amusinza nti omutukuvu 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 Mukama Katonda w'eggye eggulu n'ensi bijjudde ekitiibwa kye Mukama Katonda yeebazibwe bannange kankwase. Bannange abakungubazi mubeere bulungi Mukama abakuumi we mujje wonna tayimu gye mukozesezza okukyala okusibula omwana wange akibatizeewo Mukama yeebazibwe nnyo.
tough couple of days, you know, having to travel and then come here to this tragedy. It's not good. And thank you everybody for coming and supporting us. It means everything to me and my family. I'm gonna miss my mom a lot. She was there for me in everything I wanted, supporting every decision I made, and spent a lot of time being my sister. She was a lovely woman. She took care of us. She took us to really, really good schools and really, really good places. I saw her notes, she really liked traveling, and it's so true. She liked taking us to good places. And I know she's in a good place right now, being taken over by God.
First thing I would say is there's already enough sadness in the room. I could try and make you guys smile a little bit. All of you guys said that she's a woman of style, and that's true. It really is true. She spent so much time on her outfits. Every time she went out, she'd ask me, Tiffany, how do I look? Tiffany's my makeup right. Even for small things like going to work or something. And honestly, one of the happiest memories I have with her is when she dressed up before meeting her friends. I think mostly the Carmel group chat. She would always leave the house smelling like her perfume. And with so much happiness and joy in that moment, I felt so at peace that she was happy, you know? And I don't know about you guys, but I hope you told her how beautiful she was all the time. Because if she could hear what you're saying right now, I know she'd be delighted. That's all she ever wanted. I don't know if her mom. But I know she always made me feel insecure. She made me feel secure about myself. And sorry if I'm speaking really slowly. I'm trying to gather everything. I'm trying to think of the exact right things to say because I want you to hear what I have to say about me. In all honesty and truth, we weren't the closest of individuals. Obviously, with my teenage angst and everything, I believe that most of her love was simply because she had the obligation to love me. But as the more I hear about the stories that her friends tell me, she loved me deeply. She loved me deeply. I can't even cry anymore because I've cried too much. And I can't even put the. I wanna, cause I know. Okay, she is gone from us physically, but as she's gone, she's flooded the earth with her presence. She's all around me. And I can't feel her, but I know she's there. Even with simple things like even now, a baby crying outside, that could be her way of communicating, trying to say it's okay to believe you've got this and you can be strong and give the speech. And I'm super sick right now. You should have seen me in the morning. I couldn't even do anything. My throat was closed up. I couldn't breathe. All I could do was cry, and I couldn't even cry because my throat hurt. So all I could do is kind of clench my muscles. And then I recovered in like an hour. And I was like, why? Okay, not like why, but how? Like, this was supposed to take longer, right? I don't know. I recovered just in time to come here and give this speech. I don't know. The way I choose to see it is that she really is looking over me, guiding me. She won't let me go, honestly. I was thinking this morning, can I even come for the burial? I don't know. But she made me come. She made me come because she's my mom. And she'll forever be my mom. And I don't know if you've noticed, but in the speech I've kind of refrained from saying she was. Because she is. And she's still here with me. She's looking over me. She is my mom. She's my mom. She's our mom. She's a sister. She's a daughter. And she's here. And her love shines through all of you. I hope you know that. All of you are encouraging. Even just, I know this is going to sound very bleak, but even just seeing your sadness is enough to make me smile because I know how much you loved her. And it makes me feel like she would have loved this. You have no idea. Okay, maybe not her own funeral, but like, she would have loved how much people care about her. The last memories, I'm sorry, I saw her winding it up, but the last memories I had of her alive was when she was taking me back to school. Every time I leave her, I always have a feeling that something's up and something could happen. But this time, it was different. I knew the feeling was there, but I wasn't sad. I don't know. And the last phone call I had with her was the day right before she died. And she told me a lot of things, that I constantly replay that phone call in my mind. You have no idea. Yeah, not a single minute goes by without me thinking about that conversation. She told me so much. She told me about her. I don't want to make you guys sad. She told me she had hopes about the surgery and how when I came back, she wanted to spend so much time with me and go on enjoying life and changing how she lived her life because she cared. Then when I got the phone call in the morning, I could not believe it. I had no emotion to the point where all I could do was scream. That's the only thing I could do, and I didn't even, it felt like there was cameras on me telling me, okay, now react, because I didn't know what to do. And I had to tell my friends because I didn't want to be alone, but they didn't even know what to do, because they're all fortunate enough to have their parents with them. But once again, I remember how I said in the beginning, it's not a time for sadness, but not rejoicing either, but yes, celebrating, like it says on the programs. You have to celebrate the life of someone you love because they wouldn't want you to be sad anyway. They would want you to move on. They would want you to know that they still love you and they're always here. Even a picture is enough because it means that she's still here. Her image still exists in the world. Her voice still exists in the world somewhere. Everything exists, but her physical presence. And honestly, that was the least of it. It's her spirit which had to live on. I can't believe I haven't written anything down. I don't know. I think this is her speaking directly through me. But if I had to speak directly to her right now, with everyone in the room listening, I love you. I love you so much. I love you, and every day I cry about you. Every hour I cry about you. Every second I think about you, and I know it's going to be this way for a while. It's going to be like this for a long time. All I truly want to support, because I honestly, I don't know how many of you have ever lost your mother, but if you have, it's tough. Not even just a mother, but a father, or even someone you love. Somebody. It doesn't even have to be a person. It could be a thing, something, someone you have loved. It's taken away from you. It's hard. You have to go on your day. I'm really sick right now, but I still have to give this speech because it's the only thing giving me energy right now. And firstly, I want to say my condolences to anyone who has ever lost somebody they care about here. And if this service is bringing back any hard memories for you, I'm also very sorry about that. But I want to also thank you for coming here and supporting my mom, all of these people here. I find it a bit selfish that I barely recognize a lot of you, because my mom always kept really sheltered. Of course, I saw faces, but I could never really put faces to names. But I appreciate each and every one of you for being here. I'm gonna close now. But I really don't, I wish I could talk like this forever, but that means that this moment has to live on forever. And she would want me to move on with my life. Not forget about her, but go on with my life. And I swear, Mom, if you're listening to me, I know you are, I will make you proud. I can't let sadness defeat me. That's not what you would have wanted. As much as, you know, God takes his favorite angels. I don't know if you've heard that saying, but it's true. She's a lovely woman. She wouldn't want me to be up there with her, so I have to stay down here and comfort the one that's also loved her. And I love you so much, and I never stop thinking about you, and I wish you would show signs of you being around me more often, even if it's just like 50 days after. By the way, I'm counting the days. I don't know if I'm going to stop counting, probably like in 2 years, I don't know. I'm counting, it's just a big day of being gone, but I love you. I'll never stop thinking about you. But one day, this sadness won't be sadness. The thinking about you will turn into happiness. The next time I smile, I'll think of you. The next time I meet the love of my life, I'll think of you. The next time I suffer, I'll think of you. The next time I'm hungry, I'll think of you. The next time I'm thirsty, I'll think of you. I'll always think about you. Please don't forget that. I'll never forget you. Even if I'm 90 and I have dementia, I'll still remember you. I'll only remember you.
We are going to be the best versions of ourselves for you. And as I look at
she had, I looked at you yesterday. I saw you at peace. I last saw you one and a half years ago. And coming back to this biggest tragedy of my life, I have to say, thank you everybody again for supporting me. I will always say that. Thank you. And yes.
Thank you, everyone. Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Tiffany asked for some smile, so let's smile. Smile for the pain. But let's smile a bit. Thank you, everyone, for joining us today, for being with us. Thank you for the past 5 days. Thank you for your love, your support. For me, it's actually a blur of faces. But I thank you all from the bottom of my heart. We are a big number of siblings. And they'll introduce themselves. I would like actually everyone to give a word. So as I should go now to anything, should kneel down and pray. Or whatever was happening, prayer was the first place she went to. And then she was up and running, being busy doing this and that, solving the problem. I lived with them a couple of times and for a couple of years. And I remember that at the end of the day, she would switch off the TV, gather us in the sitting room, and we would kneel before the main sofa, side by side, her children on both sides of her, and we would pray before we went to bed. From the time she had this issue, which began a week ago, I don't remember the date, but it was a week ago.
Wednesday.
It was a whole week of pain and in and out of hospital. And the person who was with her, Donald, my sisters. I was with her on her last night on earth, and prayer was no different. We checked into the hospital on Wednesday evening. And when we finished and they taken us up to the room and we were all preparing, getting ready to just lie in the bed and complaining about all the noise in the corridor, we just said, let us pray. The nurses said we had already left the room, so she told me, Shiva, it's time to pray. We knelt down side by side in the hospital room and we prayed. I prayed fast, but I can't remember what I prayed for, but I know I prayed fast. And when I finished, she prayed a couple of things, but there were three main points that caught my attention that I would like to share with you. She prayed for her children by name, Ian and Tiffany, and she asked the Almighty to take care of them. She prayed for her family, we are a large family, and asked God to also take care of us. Then she prayed for herself, and placed her soul and spirit in God's hands and asked for his will to be done.
This prayer was different from the prayers I had had her pray before. It was a prayer of surrender, a prayer of submission. And I remember I actually opened my eyes in the middle of the prayer and looked at her and didn't really think so much of it, because after that prayer, there's a peace that descended into the room. And that peace stayed in that room. We more or less spent the night waking up and, you know, going back to sleep. We didn't really sleep that much, but it was a peace that settled, that we didn't even complain when the nurse would walk in at 3 to check in. And also when she came to wake us up at 6, I mean, we were already awake. I told Patricia to have a bath. I helped her. I dressed her into the gown. And then the nurses of the theater came to explain the situation, and Dawn also walked in. I was supposed to be in that early in the morning because he was going down with her at theater. I asked for the nurse of the theater to play for her gospel music. And then we started talking about the kind of gospel music that she should play, because she was going to be awake during the abortion. And then as they walked out, she squeezed my hand, and they walked out. I stood at the door and watched them get into the elevator. But that peace stayed. It stayed into the room even when the news came that she had passed. But I knew with certainty that Patricia was with the Lord God Almighty, a maker of heaven and earth, our Lord Jesus Christ. So we do not mourn as people without hope. We mourn as people who will see her again in eternity. So I'd like to encourage each and every one of us who is mourning here today. This earth, it's really not our home. Patricia has simply gone ahead of us. She's helping Jesus prepare our mansions. She had that habit of whenever she gets to a place earlier than everybody, she starts putting things in place. So for us, she has gone ahead. We will follow her. Ian and Tiffy, your mom loved you. You're always the conversation when we talk together. She loved you. She loved the Lord, and the Almighty loves you even more than any of us would. You guys are not alone. So we will trust in the Lord with all our hearts. We will not lean on our own understanding. In all our ways we will acknowledge him, and he shall direct our paths on this earth and one day in eternity, just as he directed Patricia. So glory be to God the Father, glory be to God the Son, glory be to God the Holy Spirit. God bless you.
Praise God. Amen. And quick introductions, we've been advised there's no time for everyone to speak. So standing with me here are Patricia's siblings from her mother's side and her siblings from her dad's side. On her dad's side, she has Martin, she has Leticia, she has Marvin, and myself. On her mom's side, she has Bob, Agnes, Judith, and Helen. Now, standing here with us are some sisters by choice. She has sisters who she chose in this world. And the first one is Pam, here, and Jackie, and others I'm sure who are sitting on the other side. The other sisters are her sisters-in-law, Rona, and maybe a potential sister-in-law for me. In the order of birth, I am the third. Sheila comes first. Patricia was second, and I was the third. When I woke up on Thursday, the 1st of December, 2022, warning, this is not going to be short, so just prepare. When I woke up on Thursday, 1st of December, 2022, I had three things on my mind. Support my sister Patricia through her post-operation needs, finalize some loadings for delivery, and attend the funeral service of the late Dr. Kansimi, which took place here. This was in addition to the other routine items on my Thursday to-do list. As a step towards item number one, I checked in at the hospital with Paul, who was at the hospital, and she assured me that Patricia, a little later than scheduled, had been taken into theater. Because Patricia had assured me multiple times not to worry about the procedure, I did not. She said it was a routine and short procedure, and she'd be out in half an hour, 1 hour maximum. I decided to stay in my office and monitor the progress through Donald Twesiga, the father of her children, whom she had specifically chosen to be the one to wait for her outside the theater. The first phone call from Donald came at maybe it was about 9-ish. He told me that the doctors had found one blockage in Patricia's artery, which they were able to fix. The second call came a little while later to tell me that they had found a second blockage, which they were able to fix. The third call was Donald telling me, read your message. So around 9:43 a.m., I checked my WhatsApp, which read, she has suffered cardiac arrest, trying to resuscitate her. Immediately, I dropped to my knees and I vowed out to go to have mercy on my sister, not to let my sister die. I rang my office bell to alert my driver, Ms. Amyakagawa, who was on standby, that we were heading to the hospital. Because I was visibly distraught, my staff were alarmed, and I told him that it was concerning my sister. In under 5 minutes, I was at the hospital wearing medical scrubs and watching the monitor screen as the doctor explained to my shaky Donald and myself that there were clots around the Patricia's heart that were not responding to their attempts at resuscitation. To be honest, it was all Greek to me, and I'm sure Donald as well, and alerted some people to pray in the 5 minutes it took for me to dash to the hospital, and I decided to leave it to them. In my days, I had the doctor say, if she survives, she'll be in ICU, blah, blah, blah. I had had enough, and I was anxious to get out of that small room with the beeping sounds and the inscriptable explanations. Thankfully, at that point, we were asked to leave and to sit outside the theater. It was time to break. I believe nothing is impossible for Almighty God, creator of all things seen and unseen. So I pray that Patricia will be healed. And as I pray, the Holy Spirit reminded me how our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane the night before he was arrested to begin that torturous journey which led to the salvation of all mankind. I prayed, Father, I pray that this cup will be taken from me, but not my will, but yours be done. And so I pray that God's will be done despite of what I was feeling. A few minutes later, one of the doctors approached us. She stood next to me and looked, and I looked up into her eyes because I was seated down. And I knew that Patricia had left us. She didn't say a word to me, but I knew that it had happened. I haven't laid my eyes on a dead person since my mother died in January 1998. Since then, I don't look at the dead. I just remember them as they were. But I asked to see Patricia, and I prayed for strength to withstand that sight. Patricia was lying on the table as if asleep. The intubation tube was still in her mouth. Evidence of the frantic attempts to save her life were visible, but she was still warm. And I had a deep sense of seemingly misplaced peace. It wasn't ordinary that I was feeling peace at that time in that environment. Our Lord Jesus Christ said in the Gospel of John, chapter 14, 27, peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. The peace of God is that assurance, that confidence that God is sovereign, he is in charge, and he is faithful. Whatever happens, that truth about him is infallible. His love is incomparable. It's like the sun. It covers all of us, and he knows best. Having said all that, the reality of the pain and implications of Patricia's passing hit home like a very fast train, leaving me breathless. Patricia's babies, especially Tiffany, how to break the news, how to tell Daddy, her mother, how to walk this journey of uncommon grief. I'm a believer in God's unequaled power to strengthen his people in times of adversity, but this is what he noticed. Grief is a mighty source of disconnection from the source of our strength, who is our Lord Almighty. Just like my phone battery which kept giving way at the most inopportune times during the coordination of these central preparations, my faith was on and off. Until this morning when I fixed my eyes on Almighty God and His glory and His majesty, what He has done in the last 2,000 years to bring mankind to Himself in love for His divine purpose. Any strength you see in me while the body of my sister lies in front of us is because of what the Lord has done in me. And that is all. I am a weak vessel. I should be lying down here and unable to speak. Let me say some things about my sister. She was physically beautiful by God's ordained plan, preordained plan. And she knew how to preserve that beauty. It was difficult being her sister in the teen years. Details are necessary, I'm sure, and you know, filling the gaps. Let's just say that thank God Mr. McGuire chose me. Yeah, thank God he did. She actually introduced us. That's how I met him. Two, she had a unique conflict strategy. Patricia was able to deploy the artillery of silence and coldness for an extended indefinite period of time. It was quite an experience to be on the receiving end of it. There was no appropriate response. You had to wait it out until, you know, she decided that now it's time, you know, to make peace. Three, she loved wholeheartedly and she knew how to sustain long-term friendships. With her ability to keep in touch and her banang, you guys, we need to meet, we've taken long. And when do we meet? In the last few years, I noticed a number of things. One, Patricia was more loving and compassionate. She told me how she stood with a friend of hers who had lost her loved ones in that ill-fated boat which capsized on Lake Victoria. She told me how she went up to the mortuary to search through the dead to identify the right ones. I couldn't believe it. The Patricia I knew would never have done such a thing. Secondly, Patricia was always joyful and happy, and she brought light wherever she went, just like Daddy said. Gone were the days of the conflict strategies. She was peace personified and a joy to be around. Her laughter was contagious and irresistible. This transformation, I believe, was the work of Jesus Christ in her, which she had accepted as her Lord and Savior. We all have our moral weaknesses, and so did Patricia, because we live in our mortal bodies, but Patricia was the best version of herself in these past few years, for which I thank God. Her illness was sudden and unexpected. Her death was shocking and devastating, but Patricia belonged to the Lord, and in His arms she rests. And for that, I give glory to God. To our family, friends, and colleagues, thank you for showering us with your love. It's not just good manners to respond to another's grief. It is God in us who moves us to stand with the bereaved. And so may God bless you all.
Let us, in a very special way, give a big hand clap to the siblings. Thank you so much for that moving communication. The church is telling us that we've run out of time, but I would like to request Ian and Tiffany's father, Uncle Don, to come.
Friends have helped financially and everything. Keep us emotionally strong. still young, and it's a trying time for all of us. Patricia was a good mother. She really cared for everyone, not only us, but also her friends around us. But, you know, she was at work on, one day she was at work, I think, 2 weeks ago, and she collapsed, and the workmates, you know, who were passing by, saw that she had collapsed, and they quickly took her to a hospital, the Kololo Hospital. They did some first aid to manage the pain she was feeling. She was had pressure, struggles breathing. Later she went home, and then I think when the pain, you know, the painkillers were starting to wear off, she started struggling again. Then she went to the Tiffany Hospital, where they also administered some painkillers, and by that time she was complaining the middle chest area is hurting, which was the hospital said that's ulcers or something like that, and, you know, that's what they say, but it was still hurting. So
issues that, but at least here, with the support of yourselves,
we're able to get where we are right now. There's a lot I would love to say about Patricia. There's a lot, and I know we'll get the time when we go to the village in Chowe, Retobo. There we'll have time, because here we're constricted by time, the church needs to, and so we have a journey to go to right after here. But all I ask and I pray is that keep us in your prayers. It won't be easy. Ian goes back on the 7th and Tiffany on the 15th. Back to the UK. We need your prayers, we need your support. And you know, the three of us really thank you so much. Thank you for being with us. The Kireju family, you're very, very great. Very grateful for even accepting me. And but we shall talk when we get there. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. For the communication. We have run out of time. We've actually overstretched our time here. The church has other activities. So our apologies. We still had speeches from the Chitanisura family, the nieces and nephews, her friend Pa, Victoria Motors, and Judiciary. Our apologies. These speeches, we'll have them when we get to Chowe. We'd like to thank you once again. We'd like to thank our church in a very special way. Continue to greet the Almighty, to strengthen our family, and may God bless each
other. Let's sing together a choir. Please lead us. Luana and Amorutaro are the first and the last stanza. Usher us to pray.
Holy Spirit, calm down every troubled heart this morning. Pray in the name of Jesus that as these your children go through this difficult, trying moment, may you reveal yourself. May each one of them come to a point of confessing that surely when Patricia departed, we saw the Lord. May someone testify that yes, as we celebrate the life of Patricia, you revealed yourself to your people. May each one of these your children be able to see you. May they be able to hear your voice. May you speak to each one of them as individuals. May they be able to hear your voice. Say, be still, I know that I am the Lord. Lord, I pray that you'll be Lord and Savior in every troubled heart. Then will they be able to know that surely
you who promised never to leave, never to depart, you are surely with them. And so we pray that King of Majesty, as they walk through this difficult, darkest hour of the days of God, may they stand like David said when he said that even though I go through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil, for thy rod and your staff comfort me. Will you comfort them? Will you cause them, King of Glory, to smile, not because they are happy Patricia is gone, but to smile knowing that there is a place made for each one of us who believes in you. Lord, to you we surrender, especially when it comes to the time of travel, as they go on the journeys, Lord, with many vehicles on the road. We ask for your presence. We ask for your protection. We ask you, King of Glory, to move with these, your people. Lord, may your presence be with them. And as you travel with them, as they go, King of Glory, to the village, may your presence scatter every evil. May your presence scatter every work of the enemy. May you uproot every plan of the devil. Lord, we come against every spirit of accidents in the name of Jesus. I pray that, Lord, you cover them with the blood of Jesus. Cover every vehicle with your precious blood. Cover the roads with the blood of Jesus. We pray in the name of Jesus. The Lord, you will protect every road user. Those driving, those walking, those moving in different ways. We pray, King of Glory, that there will be no accidents. You will take them safely and return them safely. And that honor and glory will return to you. Thank you, Lord, for all the testimonies, all that has been said about Patricia. Thank you. Father, may you continue to give your children strength. May you help them all through. We give you all the honor and the glory. We bless you, we worship you, and we honor you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now, beloved, the blessing of God Almighty, that blessing which is rich and adds no sorrow, rest upon each one of you. May that blessing of God keep you, be with you, be with your loved ones. Go with you even as you walk through this difficult moment. May that blessing keep you now and always. Amen. Amen. You may take your seat just for a minute. May I invite someone to represent the family to receive what we have offered. We have together collected 2,388,500 shillings. Our family representative, please receive. Okay, thank you once again. Choir, thank you for ministering. Please sing What a Friend We Have in Jesus. May the Lord bless you even as you travel. Okay, MC wants to direct the people that will go for burial. Please quickly, MC, directions.
Thank you very much, Reverend. Two announcements. One is that those who registered for the group transportation, the vehicle is parked. When you walk out of this door, at the gate, it's the hostel. You're looking at directly in front. We are going for burial right now in Tungamo district. Tungamo district is after Barra. After Barra, you get to Tungamo town. After Tungamo town, you go through River Ale. You reach Rentobo. Just as you're coming out of Rentobo, you take your left, we shall put banana plantations to signal the direction. Hey, the plants! It's not possible to put a whole plantation. We shall put banana plants, and they will be showing you the direction right from the road where you branch off on your left, all the way until the home. Our burial will be tomorrow at 11 a.m., but when we reach today, for those traveling, we shall have a hold vigil at night, and then pray, and then tomorrow we shall have the burial starting at 11 a.m. Thank you very much, and may God bless you.
Thank you so much, Nelson. Please, choir.
What a friend we have in Jesus. We'll all arise as we sing that final song.